favorite songs ever that I'm fixing to sing right here. A song that was very instrumental in my life. I've told this story about pulling over the yellow dump truck and just crying on the side of the road. And it was this song right here that got me. I'd listen to this thing, I swear to my goodness, I'd listen to it 150 times and just couldn't get over what it kept saying in my heart every time I'd listen to it. So I hope it blesses you this morning. It's God with us.
Nevertheless, I lay this down.
come, where she goes. We cut that every time, baby. All right. You'll keep us on that G, Miss Margaret. Father, we come before you right now. This will be our offertory time. Lord, we just come to give back to you as you've given to us. Everything I am, every second of my life, every breath that I take, if I were to give it all to you, it would be such a tiny thing compared to Calvary. That massive mark and mountain of God where the salvation of mankind was purchased. Me is one of the just tiny, one of the billions. Giving you everything I have would be just so small. And Father, the truth is I haven't done that. I've taken the little tiny life I had and I've made it my own and ran where I wanted to with it. Not even considered you in the equation so many times. So Father, I don't know where everybody's at this morning, Lord. But I tell you what, in my spirit, I feel heavy hearts. I feel those that want to break loose and let go. But Father, they've done it before, and they hadn't got where they thought they were going to get. And now they're filled with reservations and filled with doubts, filled with holding back. Father, to that right now, Lord, I just lift up the fact that you just keep going at it. You go at it until you get it right. The just man falls 7 times, but he rises again. He just keeps going at it until he gets it right. He lays his pride aside. He lets it fall in the dust, and he keeps doing it until he gets it right. Trusting you, looking to you through the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit to make that happen in his life. Father, I pray you move on each and every heart for us to get a clear vision of who you are, what you're worth. And that we determine and decide to give you everything. To give you everything all the time. Surrendered and submitted unto you. Father, this is the time of returning to you that which you've given us financially during this week. So that we can eat. So that we can have electricity. So that we can drive. So we can provide clothing, necessities, and essentials for our family. Father, living where we live, we get all sorts of stuff that we don't need, that we just want. You have blessed us beyond measure. Father, I pray you touch each and every heart. Let us not be stingy. Let us not be selfish. Let us perhaps even reconsider what our offering is this morning. Let us make sure it's been prayed about, prayed over, trusting you in it, and looking to you concerning it. So just move now during this offertory time. Let it be exactly what it is, a part of our worship. To you. We can worship you lifting our hands. We can worship you clapping. We can worship you singing. Lord, if we start drawing lines about where we're going to stop and where we're going to go at, Father, it taints everything. So, Father, I just pray you give cheerful hearts to give unto you now. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. I'll do it one more time. I want you to think about what you're saying. How great is he? How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. love that song we just did. Because we all think we get this figured out, don't we? I know how God is. I know how God does. I know what he's going to do. I know what he's not going to do. Blah, 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 blah. As if he's, how would you put that? Figure-outable. Amen? I like the idea that God's the ocean and my mind's a Dixie cup. Come on. My mind's just a Dixie cup. I can go down to Holly Beach and scoop up a little bit, but that's about all I can handle at one time, amen? And he goes deep, and he goes wide, and he goes farther than I could possibly imagine, and he has this thing figured out for me if I just accept it, amen? And then you know what he does? He turns around and he brings me in. Draws me to himself. Says, I'll be a father to you. I'll watch over you. I'll be the one that takes care of you and supplies for you in all my ability and all my power. I want you to consider that as you listen to this song. I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like. Pleasing that I'm my soul this morning, that one so great would love one like me. Why, Lord Jesus, would you do something like that for someone like me? Why would you go to the cross and pay my debt of sin? Why would you keep me from hell and all its eternal torments to draw me unto yourself? And as if that wouldn't be enough, you said, I place the solitary in families. I'll be a father to the fatherless. But you are there to embrace, listen, counsel, hold, love, guide, direct me in all of my ways. Father, I have no accusation against you. What could I lift up and complain? Where could I point out fault in how you've dealt with me? I cannot. And like that song says, you are perfect in all of your ways toward us, in the things you do and the things you allow and the way you work in our lives, Lord. You are perfect. If there's anything askew, if there's anything missing, it's in us. Lord Jesus, I thank you for saving me. I thank you for the fact that I'm headed to heaven. You are even right now preparing a place for me to reside with you. Let that grab hold of my heart. Let me not treat that as common because it's holy. And it means everything to me. And I don't want it to get lost or buried or set aside or covered over by other issues. I want them to make way. I want them to get gone so that you might be glorified in my life. Indeed an awesome God, and you are God alone, and we love you and we praise you. You are a good father to us. You take care of us and you supply for us. We give you all the praise that's due you now, Lord Jesus. We ask all of this morning. This is all for you, and we ask it for your name's sake. Amen. You can be seated. And you know what I'm going to do this morning? You're going to be so happy with me, I think. No, you're not. You're going to be so happy with me, I think. I am not going to keep you very long. Matter of fact, at this point in time, it is 11:45. I believe you will be out of here by 12 o'clock. Because you know what? Things aren't accomplished and things aren't done by a multitude of words. It's done by getting to the point. So I'm going to get to the point this morning. Amen? Is that okay with everybody? Just get to the point. Get to it. Don't beat around the bush. Just direct ourselves to it. Well, I'm going to tell you what. I look around and I see some of the things that that take place, and I see how we get caught up in all the issues and situations. And I think what we need more than anything is just a clear vision, like I said at the beginning of this morning, of the one who saved us. We need a clear vision of who God is, because he's worth everything. Amen? He's worth everything. I want you to stew on that for just a second. I've got a couple of announcements, and we're going to get to a Bible verse here or two, and I want to share them with you, but I want to share this. I have this little picture right here, and that's Miss Stormy, and her picture is sitting out on the table. She has graduated from the school down there. Amen. So she can now operate the plant. Amen. Is that correct, Miss Stormy? You're now ready to operate the plant. Is that correct? Amen. Praise God. Clap for her again. Amen. Amen. Along with that, talking of graduations, we have another man that is just bold enough to wear pretty much a pink shirt. Not exactly, but close enough, we're going to call it. Amen. Dallas, graduating senior from Singer High School. Amen. Clap for that. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Need to support those things. So if you want to support those things, his graduation is Friday the 12th at 7 p.m. up in Singer, Louisiana. Amen. at the Singer High School. Amen? So Friday the 12th at 7 p.m. All right. And I'm going to come back to this in a minute because there's something important on the back I want to talk to you about. But right now, I want to get to these other things. I can't put that there. Let me put it here. All right. Why don't you go to Isaiah chapter 66? Isaiah chapter 66. If you get past Psalms and Proverbs, Isaiah is a big old book with a bunch of chapters right behind all that, so it shouldn't be too hard for you to find. I want to ask you something. In your life, is God worth everything to you? If he wanted all your money right now, would you give it to him? If he wanted your home that you just bought and spent a year putting up, would you let him have it? Is there anything you're holding back, anything you withhold? See, because I happen to believe that he is worth everything. If he wanted your 401k retirement that you've been working on for 30 years, and he said, I want you to take that and send it to an orphanage in Africa, would that be okay with you? Without figuring out what you're going to do behind that, but just because he said to. You know, because I want you to understand something. There are people that live on the planet that do stuff like that. Amen? You know that, right? Everybody knows that, right? They're called upon of God to do the great, the dramatic, as it were, and they just willingly do that. They're willing to just give it all away. They're all in. Amen? And you know what? How many of you need a breakthrough? How many of you need a breakthrough? Amen? You got things that have been lingering, that have been holding on, that have been going on, that you've been dealing with time after time after time after time, and you just need it to get done and over with. You're frustrated. You feel like you're up against the wall. Amen? Feel like you're in the rut, however you want to describe that, right? Just those, all those things we use to talk about those things. Just languishing away in the slough of despond, trudging along, not being able to get loose. Amen? Well, let me tell you something. You get the breakthrough by being all in. That's where the breakthrough comes in. You're just all in. You're just like, whatever, Jesus. You know what? Just whatever you want. I'm willing to give everything, do anything, however it is you want me to do. I am looking, directing, and depending on you totally and completely. I'm not trying. I'm not assessing. I'm not figuring. I'm not fussing. I'm not anything. I'm just looking to you. And I want everybody in here to have that. So I've got three places we're going to go to real quick, and I'm just going to show you some specific things about these verses. I'm going to tie it all together, and then I'm going to throw something else at you, okay? And then you're going to get out of here, and you're going to be happy. Isaiah 66, verse 1. Thus saith the Lord, the heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool. Where is the house that you would build unto me, and where is the place of my rest? For all these things hath mine hand made, and all these things have been, saith the Lord. But to this man will I look, even to him that is poor and of a contrite spirit, and trembleth at my words. Verse 3 says, he that killeth an ox is as if he slew a man. He that sacrifices a lamb is as if he cut off a dog's neck. He that offereth an oblation as if he offered swine's blood. He that burneth incense as if he blessed an idol. Yea, they have chosen their ways, and their soul delighteth in their abominations. I also will choose their delusions and will bring their fears upon them, because when I called, none did answer. When I spake, they did not hear, but they did evil before mine eyes and chose that which I delighted not. Hear the word of the Lord, ye that tremble at his word. Your brethren that hated you, that cast you out for my name's sake, said, let the Lord be glorified, but he shall appear to your joy, and they shall be ashamed. I want to just take those verses, and I'm not going to pray over it. We've already prayed. We've lifted all that up. I just want to say this to you. God's talking to these people, and they're busy building him a temple. Okay? They're busy. The little Israelites are busy building this temple, and they're all in, man. They're just working and slaving and doing and all this, that, and the other. And God says, just so you don't get sideways on this thing, he said, understand one thing. And what's he begin with? He says, the heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool. Amen. He says, so where's this house you're building me? He said, if I am so all-encompassing, if I am so great, grand, and glorious beyond your comprehension that the heavens are my throne and the earth is just where I rest my feet. Amen. He said, now where's that house you're building me at? He said, because obviously I need it. He says, where is this dwelling place that you're making for me? And then he adds, everything you're building, everything you're doing, he said, my hands made it in the first place, amen? Every tree you cut, I made the tree. Every rock you pull out, I made the rock, amen? Every mortar you put together, I gave the ingredients to do that with. Every talent you have, I gave that to you also, amen? Correct? See, we get messed up in our position in this thing, and we somehow think that God's at our disposal to do what we want him to do when we want him to do it. And we forget that everything we have comes from him, originates from him. You have nothing you can give him, amen, that's not already his. Even if I gave him, as I was talking about earlier, this tiny offering, just said, here it is, 100%, all 100% of the time, all the time, everywhere, all the time. You know what? I'm still giving him something that's his because he's the one that made me in the first place. Amen? Do you get what I'm saying? You have nothing to add to the equation. You're at a zero. Amen? The money you have, you're giving him back what he gave you. Amen? Bless you with strength, give you opportunity, provide you a job. I mean, you're right back as it's a zero-sum game on our side. We have nothing to offer, and we so often forget that. If somebody would get up and turn those air conditioners off for me, just click them off, I would appreciate that. Look at that. Lolly took off at a sprint. She's like, I've been freezing for 30 minutes now. Amen? Just cut those down. I'm sorry. We like that for the band, but I meant to get that turned off. Poor little Miss Anise. Somebody ought to just hug her up. She's all bundled up over there underneath the blanket. She's fixing to start a campfire. Amen. All right. But look, we get all messed up in this thing, and we think somehow that it's about us. We start having this self-centered salvation. You've heard me talk about it before. Amen. This movie is not about you. You are not the star of the show. You're not even the supporting actor or actress. Amen? If we're lucky, our names are going to come in on the credits at the end of the movie. Amen? When we get to heaven, they start breaking out that Lamb's Book of Life. There'll be my name. I guarantee you, I'm not getting any notice up until that point. It's not, you know, starring and it says, like, number four on the list, Tony Crozier. Trust me, ain't going to happen. Amen? But we get all puffed up within ourselves and think God's here for me. He's here for me. Understand this. You're here for him. You get that? You're here for him. You are not your own. You are the sheep of his pasture. You are the one that he created. And we're like, well, I've been praying and God ain't said nothing to me. I love this, man. Verse 4, he said, I will also choose their delusion and breathe their fears upon him, because when I called, none answered. What? God says, you complain about when you call to me, I don't answer you. He said, what about when I call to you? He said, I don't get no answers. He said, where are those that answer me when I put out the call? I want you to live like this. I want you to do this. I want you to be obedient. And he brings it up twice in here. He says in verse 2, those that tremble at my word. He says that where is it at again? Verse 5, he says, hear the word of the Lord, ye that tremble at his word. He said, I'm doing all sorts of talking. And everybody's just ignoring what I say and going and doing what they want to do. Somebody say, amen, oh me, stop it, quit, make it go away, whatever you want to say, but listen to me. He said, I'm speaking all the time. He said, matter of fact, when you walk outside, he says, the heavens are declaring my glory. They're looking you in the face, the beautiful sunrise. Think about I've read that in the devotional, the beautiful way God brings the day in with the sun breaking over the things, shooting through the trees or casting itself across the water, and then the glorious way he wraps it up in the evening time. He said, I'm getting your attention. I'm speaking all the time. He said, but I can't get anybody to answer me. Yeah, amen. But we think every time we pop out a verse, a word, a thought, an idea, an ask, a request, or whatever, God's supposed to just drop everything he's doing with the rest of the creation and come running to our aid and assistance and do what we want, when we want, as we want, right now. Amen? But when he speaks to us, we don't answer. And look, this was busy people. Okay? They were busy. They were doing stuff. They were building the temple to the Lord. They're busy. They're getting after it. But he says, you know what? He says, you've gotten so sideways. He said, your offerings. He said, when you offer me an ox, it's as if you're offering me a human sacrifice. It's repulsive to me. He says, you sacrifice the lamb, it's as if you've cut off a dog's head and thrown it at the altar. Could you imagine that? Just imagine the holy altar of God, and he says, it's like you're offering human sacrifice and throwing dead dogs at the altar. He says, on top of that, he says, you offer an oblation or a meal offering. He says, it's like you're offering swine's blood. He says, you know why? Because you've chosen your own way. You've chosen your own way. You want the breakthrough? Start doing it God's way. I mean, honestly, I mean, good night. I'm not allowed to use profanity, so about best I can do is dadgummit. Just start doing it God's way. Huh? Not God's way the way you want it. Not God's way applied to everybody else except you, amen, because we're really good about that. You need to get right with Jesus, amen. Here's what you need to do. We got verses to back it up and all that stuff. What about within your own self? He said, because they've turned to their own way, even the things they do are putrefying to me, as though it's human sacrifice, dog sacrifice, swine's blood being thrown at the altar of offering. You know, look, us up here singing, that ought to get our attention, because I don't want to be throwing that at Jesus when I'm up here singing. I don't want to be like that. I don't want my offering that I give financially or however other way I get it to be something that's a stench in God's nose because of the disobedience that I won't deal with in my life, because of the issues I won't let go, because of the repentance I won't have, because of the confession I won't do, because of all the hiding I've got going on instead of bringing it out and laying it out and getting it taken care of. I don't want those things to be wrong in my life to where even the good things I do aren't good anymore. Amen? Y'all believe that can happen? Yeah, it can get like that. He's telling them that right there. He says, and the resolution of this thing is that you tremble at my word. Because here's why you should tremble at God's word. Because God's going to back his word up. Amen? We live on a planet full of talkers. Amen? You might be one. I'm pretty sure I am. Amen? And we talk and we spout things out and we say and we lay things down. And then you know what? We never back it up. Understand this. God is going to back up everything he's put out. Amen? Everything he's spoken, he's going to back up. So I want you to see this busy people that are twisted up. And you know why? If you've been in church at all, you've heard this before, because they have a form of godliness, but they're denying the power thereof. You know, one of the things God did with me is he just kept attacking everything I knew and everything I saw around me for what passes as Christianity in America. Y'all getting that? He said, get down to being raw, uncut, listening to what I say and doing what I say just as I say it. Amen? You know what? Because Christianity in America wouldn't accept a guy like Paul, who was homeless and beaten and stinking and ostracized and cast out. I mean, if they didn't drive up in a nice vehicle and have a nice suit and look like they'd attained something and accomplished something, nobody would even want to listen to him. Amen? Come on, somebody talk to me. You know, Christianity in America wouldn't have much use for Jesus to come in with his dirty, bloody feet and mess up our carpet, amen? Somebody'd be freaking out about that, correct? Because we have a certain picture and a certain expectation and a certain idea about how this is supposed to be, amen? Somebody work with me here. If I'm just making stuff up, tell me to stop, and I will. I'm just saying we live in a warped version of what God had intended. And he says in that warped version, there's this thing that you go and you listen and it's a spectator sport and you hear the message and you're like, wow, that was awesome. That jacked me up. That got my attention. That stepped all over my toes. That hurt me. And then you go back out and you go right back to your own ways and wonder why nothing ever gets better. And then you wonder why your offerings are not being accepted, why it seems like there's no regard from God on the things you do. He's saying, because I've spoken and you're not hearing me. If you back up to verse 6, or chapter 6 of Isaiah now, we see this people all centered on themselves, all doing as they do. And I've already lied to you because it's 3 minutes after 12 right now. but I'll still hurry. And I didn't want anybody going anywhere because I want everybody to hear this because it applies to families as a whole. I mean, that's some of the issues we have too, issues with families and situations in that. You know, that we got to start doing our families the way God says to do them. Try that again. We got to start doing our families the way God says to do them. Not how we've been doing them, not how we put it together, not how we patched it together. You know, because God's really not a good fixer. You get that? Yeah, did you like that? I love doing that to Miss Ashley because he's just like, what are you talking about? I thought he was here to fix me now. I mean, what's going on? No, he's a good recreator, but he's not a good fixer. He doesn't do patch jobs. He'll crush the whole vessel and then bring it back up in beauty. He won't just patch something up on the side and try to rub it and blend it in. Amen? When it's spinning on the potter's wheel, as it talks about in Jeremiah, when the vessel gets marred, the creator takes the whole thing and just smashes it down to the bottom and recreates it back into what it was supposed to be. He doesn't stop and grab some other clay and try to slap it on the side as it's going around and make it blend in and patch it up. That's what we do, amen? So when I say God's not a good fixer, I'm saying he's not trying to just fix and patch up things in your life. He wants to recreate and give you a brand new marriage, brand new family, brand new life, brand new enjoyment, and a new purpose, amen? He wants to recreate that. So what we have to do is we have to get a vision of him here in Isaiah chapter 6. It says in verse 1, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train or his robe filled the temple. Above it stood the seraphims. Each one had six wings, and with twain or two he covered his face, with two he covered his feet, and with two he did fly. And they cried, one cried unto another, saying, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the posts of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke. Then said I, Woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Let me just stop there, and let me take you out of 2017 America, and imagine putting you in the immediate holy presence of God, considering everything you're surrounded with on your TV, on your radio, with the other people you dwell with, and how that would impact you to be in the perfect righteousness, that pure life that is complete and undefiled, and to find yourself suddenly at his feet. I believe you'd be the same way, saying, man, I am completely undone. I've been surrounded by ugly, dirty, disgusting people, ugly, dirty, disgusting things, and I'm ugly, dirty, and disgusting myself. Amen? And that's what happened to him. He got a vision. You know when he got that vision? When the human means were taken away. I love that. What did the verse start out? In the year that King Uzziah died. King Uzziah had reigned for 52 years. That means at 53, as far as my little life would be concerned, he'd have been my king my whole life. Amen? And he was a good king. And he took care of his business, and he served his people. He was godly. He led them the right direction. Things had gone well. But now he had died and was taken out of the way. See, we don't even get that because we have presidents that last about 4 years, maybe eight tops. Amen? A continual rotation, but to have someone that had been there your whole life, leading and protecting, guiding and directing, and then all of a sudden they're gone. See, the human means was moved out of the way. That's when Isaiah says, then I saw the Lord high and lifted, and I understood that it doesn't matter about the human means because there's one behind it that's greater than that. That's going to watch over me, that's going to take care of me. And I love this. It talks about the seraphims there flying around with two wings are covering their face, and they can't look at the glory of God. And with two other wings, they're covering their feet, lest their feet touch the ground where the holy God sits. And they're flying back and forth, and they're just circling the throne going, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And you know what? They've been doing that the whole time you've been in church today. Do you know that? They're doing it right now while I'm talking about it. When we break up and hug and say goodbye and you head home, they're going to be doing that, flying around the throne of God, declaring and decrying out his holiness over and over and over again. And you know what? We just don't get that. Would you agree with me? We don't get that. I don't have any rights in the light of that. I don't have any rights to myself in the light of that. I have nothing but falling on my face and say, hey, what do you want me to do? What do you need from me? I mean, if the seraphim continually 24/7 for all eternity have been crying out how holy you are and they're surrounding you, if you stand before 100 million angels, amen, and they all fall at their face in front of him, you know what? I'm just going to tell you, 100 million angels can't be wrong, amen? Might be time for you to go ahead and take a knee too and start saying, you know what? What do you want from me? Not what do I need from you, what do you want from me? You are so glorious, so powerful, so worthy. I should be serving you instead of always trying to get you to serve me. It says, then flew, verse 6, one of the seraphim unto me, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken off the tongs from the altar, and he laid it upon my mouth, and he said, lo, this hath touched thy lips, and thine iniquity is taken away, and thy sin is purged. Also I heard the voice of the Lord saying, who shall I send and who will go for me? Then said I, Isaiah says, here I am, send me. From the altar of sacrifice, there was a purging and a cleansing, just like this altar of sacrifice right here that has purged and cleansed us, that makes you fit. Do you understand that? That makes you fit to serve God. You understand that? That sacrifice that takes place here, that coal from the altar of sacrifice, cleanses him and makes him fit to serve God. Then God poses the question he does to each and every one of us. Who will stand for me? Who will go for me? Who will live for me? And in the light of the seraphims and the 100 million angels that are bowed at his feet constantly, you know what? The answer ought to be, here I am, send me. What do you want? You want my retirement? You want my house? You want my car? You want my food? You want whatever you want? You can have it all because I'm here to serve you. If you don't want anything, that's fine too. Doesn't matter. You just call it and you can have it. I am here to serve you. I'm not here to get you to serve me. Amen. That's the attitude of heart we need. You want some breakthrough in your life? That's the attitude of heart we need. Let's go back to Daniel chapter 3. And I didn't mark mine either, so I'll be hunting it up here too with you. Got to think about where it's at myself. Should be on the other side of this, if I'm not mistaken. Somebody help me. Where are my Bible scholars at? Amen. Dun, dun, dun. Yeah, about that far past it. Amen. That, if you're in Isaiah 6, you're about that far away going that way to Daniel. And I want you to get to Daniel chapter 3. Daniel chapter 3. Let's start in verse 13. Daniel chapter 3, verse 13. This is who I want to be. This is how I want to be. This is how we need to be as the future Journey Baptist Church. And trust me, we're working on that, okay? It's killing me. That's got to get done. I got laid off Friday or Thursday, you know. I made it down to the last four. They only keep two. And anyway, that's all good, amen? So anyhow, so I'm here. And we're going to get this done. We're going to get this done quickly. It's got to get ended and get wrapped up. But this is who we have to be. If we're going to accomplish the things God has for us, we have to be surrendered, submitted unto him, just like those seraphims, just like those 100 million angels. We have got to be surrendered to him. Verse 13, then Nebuchadnezzar in his rage and his fury commanded to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Then they brought these men before the king. Nebuchadnezzar spake and said unto them, is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, do not ye serve my gods, nor worship the golden image which I have set up. Now, listen right here. The king had set up a golden image. King Nebuchadnezzar had set up this golden image, and when the music went off, you were supposed to drop what you were doing, face the image, bow down, and worship it. Okay? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, being like us, said, I can't worship that because I worship him. Amen? So I just can't do that for you. So the king calls him in. He's furious. He's like, look, I've spent time, money, effort, built this huge statue out there. And I think it was an Ephesus of himself along with that. And the point being, you were supposed to bow down and worship that every time the music goes off, and you ain't doing it. So he gives him a chance. Verse 15. Now, if you be ready, that at the time you hear the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, and dulcimer, and all kinds of music, you fall down and worship the image which I have made, everything will be well. But if you worship not, you shall be cast the same hour in the midst of a burning fiery furnace. And who is the God that shall deliver you out of my hands? So he finds out they haven't been doing it. And he says, but here's the deal. If you're ready to do it from here on out, we can resolve this issue and you can go on about your way. All you got to do is from here on out, when the music sounds, drop what you're doing, face the image, get on your knees and worship it. He says, so we can resolve this. No harm, no foul. Charges to be dropped. Everybody goes home. Everybody's happy. Amen. He said, but if you don't, I'm going to throw you alive into a fiery furnace. Big brick furnace. Get it all heated up, nice and hot. I'm just going to chunk you in there alive because you're going to be the example for what happens to people that don't do what I tell them to do. And he says, while you're thinking about it, just in case you're thinking this, he said, and who's this God you're serving that's going to come rescue you? He said, who is this God that shall deliver you out of my hands? Verse 16, read with me because this is good stuff. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer thee in this matter. In other words, we don't have to think about it. We don't need to talk about it. We don't have to have a discussion. We're not going to vote. Amen. We're pretty certain we have a straight up answer for you right off the bat. He said, verse 17, if it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. But if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden images which thou hast set up. You get what they said? They said, you know what? It don't matter to us. He said, you're talking about the God that's able to deliver us? He said, if he shows up on scene, smites all of y'all, you know, lightning bolts start flashing and all this, that, and there, he comes and scoops us up in his arms and takes care of us. He said, that's okay. He said, but you know what? If he don't, he's God enough that I'm willing to die for him, amen? I'm willing to give him all, even my life, unto my life, willing to give it to him. So that's okay too, amen? He says, so we don't have to think this over, but here's what we're not going to do. We're not going to bow down to your idol, no matter what music you play, amen? No matter what time of the day you do it, what direction, how you polish it, how you adorn it, how you set it up, doesn't matter. Not going to bow down, amen? I love that. Always makes me think of 300, the movie 300, amen? When the Xerxes is trying to get, come on, what's his name? Huh? Yes, trying to get him to bow down. He said, I've been too busy killing your guys, man. I got a cramp, so I really can't bow right now. Amen. Praise God. That's how I want to be spiritually. Amen. Been too busy getting people saved, snatching them out of your kingdom, getting them baptized at that church there in De Quincy. So I'm just too tired to take a knee for you right now. Amen. And just be smart about it. Amen. Come on, praise God. That ought to get some clapping. Just be smart about it. I'm going to serve God because I'm too busy serving him, lifting him up, shining light on people, and seeing things change in their life. So I don't have time to stop some paltry, sucky worship of you. Amen? That's right. That's what they said. We don't have to think about that. We don't have to talk about that. Verse 19, then was Nebuchadnezzar full of fury, and the form of his visage was changed against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Now, I like the way the Bible's written sometimes. It doesn't just say he was upset. I mean, he was so mad that, like, the blood things are just popping out of his forehead, his neck. He's got the big veins. I mean, just everything. He was he's like, I'm the king. You understand me? Don't come in and talk to the king like that. Think about that. Because they were very dismissive. It's like Nebuchadnezzar, you just really don't impress us that much. Man, is that good stuff? You know why he didn't impress them that much? Because they had this big, huge, stinking God that they were serving, that they knew was watching over them, and that no matter what happened, it didn't really make any difference, because if they left here, they'd just be there with him, amen? So that's all right. Send me to heaven, amen? Scare me with that. Not going to work for you, amen? I love that stuff. They're just dismissive and say, we're not afraid of you. We have a glorious God we serve, and we're not taking a knee to anybody but to him. Amen? Man, that ought to be something you're doing in your life. You understand that? I want you to get that. Quit taking knees to things that aren't him. Quit taking knees to websites you shouldn't be at. Quit taking knees to TV shows you shouldn't be watching. Quit taking knees to circumstances you shouldn't be in. Quit taking a knee to conversations you shouldn't be having. Quit taking a knee to music you shouldn't be listening to. Come on, I'm getting down to it, man. All that, man. It's just however it's presented, however it's represented. It comes from a different kingdom, amen. And I'm not worshiping in that kingdom no more. I'm worshiping in this one, amen. So I want the stuff that has to do with this kingdom, praise God. Isn't that right? I have no time for the rest of that because I don't live there anymore, amen. I live here now, and I'm serving somebody else. There'll be no knees given to anybody except to Jesus Christ, my Heavenly Father and the Holy Spirit, amen. Just to them and them alone. As they lead, guide, and direct, and I serve them. He said, and he commanded the mighty men, verse 20, that were in his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and to cast them into the fiery furnace, the burning fiery furnace. Then were these men bound in their coats and their hosen, their hats and their other garments, and they were cast into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Therefore, because the king's commandment was urgent and the furnace exceedingly hot, the flames of the fire slew the men that took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. You get that? Huh? That's hot. That's hot. That means the guys that walked up to throw them in, to get close enough to throw them in, and end up killing them because it was so stinking hot. Amen? I've been around one time in my life, I was setting a field on fire, and for a moment, I got cornered up between the fence and the fire. And there is a point that the fire just gets too hot. Do you understand me? I mean, it just not ain't good anymore. All right? It's like you just right there at about the blistering and boiling point, and it's hot. Everything changes in that moment. And that's where the fence climbing came in, amen? I quit trying to beat it with that stupid shovel and rake I had, and I'm just leaving, amen? And I left the shovel and the rake, because it's hot. It's so hot, when they go to throw them in, the guys throwing them in get killed. Verse 23, and these three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell down bound in the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Then Nebuchadnezzar the king was astonished and rose up in haste, and spoke unto his counselors, saying, did we not cast three men bound into the midst of the fire? And they answered and said unto the king, true, O king. So I throw these three guys in. The king's looking. He's watching all the goings on. All of a sudden he gets up and he's leaning forward and he's looking. He says, hang on a minute. He says, we only threw three guys in there, right? He said, one of the guys that died didn't roll off in there or anything, huh? We threw three, right? Oh, yeah, only three. Verse 25, he answered and said, lo, I see four men loose, walking in the midst of the fire, and they have no hurt, and the form of the fourth is like the Son of God. What? What? I love that. In the midst of the fiery trial, who shows up? In the midst of the hurt and the pain, the sorrow and the suffering, who shows up? At the very end, when it seems there's no hope and this is it, man, everything's against you, the other king is winning out and he's going to take you back down like he used to have you and all that's coming to an end, who shows up? Even Nebuchadnezzar recognized who it was. This pagan king says, man, that looks like the Son of God right there. I know we only threw three in, and there's four walking around in there, and they're walking around loose. Now, wait a minute, walking around in the fire that just killed the guys that threw you in, that's a pretty good feat, amen? That'll get somebody's attention. Then Nebuchadnezzar came near to the mouth of the burning fiery furnace and spake and said, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, ye servants of the Most High God, come forth and come hither. Then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came forth of the midst of the fire. And the princes, governors, and captains, and the king's counselors being gathered together saw these men upon whose bodies the fire had no power, nor was a hair of their head singed, neither were their coats changed, nor the smell of the fire had passed. They didn't even smell like smoke. Huh? Now, you know when somebody's been at a barbecue, amen? Ain't no two ways about you telling they've been at a barbecue. You can smell them from about 10 feet away. These guys been in the fire, walked back out. Their clothes haven't been burnt. Their hair hasn't even been singed. And they don't even smell like smoke. Because Jesus showed up in the middle of this. And completely, I'm just going to tell you the rest of it, completely changes the king's heart. And he begins to feebly try to follow this God that he's seen displayed before his eyes. I want to be like them. Because you know what? I don't care if I get burned up or not. Huh? I don't care. If Jesus decides to show up and just walk around, we walk around the fire, that would be the coolest thing ever, wouldn't it? Amen? I want to be like Peter. I'll get outside the boat and just go to walking, act like I can. Amen? Huh? You know, the other ones didn't start drowning, but you know what? They never got to walk on water either, so I'm the one. I'm going to get out. Amen? We're going to get out and just give this a shot. Amen? You said to get out. I'm getting out. Amen? That's how we've got to follow him, how we've got to serve him. Quit looking for him to take care of you and start taking care of the things he has for you to do. Quit wanting him to serve you and start serving him. Whatever the situation is that he puts you in, whatever the thing is that you're battling against, whatever the fiery furnace might be in your life, you know what? I'm just going to walk right into it. I'm not concerned about that. I don't have to think about this challenge. I don't have to think about this situation. I'm going to trust the Most High God who saved me through the blood of his Son on the cross of Calvary, and I'm going to depend on him to get me through this. I'm going to quit running around whining, moaning, crying like I don't have a God to call out to. Amen? Miss Lolly, if you get upstairs for me real quick with just some music. I mean, I'm telling you what, we have such a glorious God that's able to do so much more than we can possibly imagine. I don't want to fail him. I don't want to fall short for him. I don't want to leave things undone that need to be taken care of. You moms and dads, you got families to lift up. You know where we live. You know, and I'm not talking about De Quincey. I'm talking about in this planet that is loaded down with filth smut that is about two clicks away. Amen? All over the place. Whether you're talking about hateful stuff, whether you're talking about just harmful stuff, whether you're talking about inappropriate sexual stuff, it is surrounded. It's just everywhere. You know what? It used to be that if you'd be out in the country, you'd be safe. Amen? But now they've gotten it to where they can bring like downtown New York City right out to Sanger, to Oretta. Amen? That's right. Anywhere the signal comes in, they can bring every piece of filth that you would never imagine where it's supposed to be clean and pristine, and they can just pump it right in there too. Amen? Don't take a knee. I don't care. I don't care. You shouldn't care. If your children like it or not, who cares? You know what? Till you show me I can trust you, till I'm certain of you, no, you're not getting access to that. Not just because, like, that's the stupidest thing. Because it's there, they're supposed to be able to get there. No. You're the parents. You've got to make those determinations, make those decisions, guide that family, watch over them. You know what? Well, what age? I don't know when they're old enough. Amen? They're not a set age. You know, you magically turn this age. Somebody did that with 18 and 16. You know, 16 for driver's license, 18, you're an adult. That's a laugher, ain't it? Huh? Who in here was an adult when you were 18? Well, all of you legally were, but you know what? You weren't. Amen? I'm having a hard time being one at 53, so I know I wasn't at 18. Amen? Are they? Yeah, there you go. Yeah. Oh, golly, man. Oh, don't even get me started on that one. I'm going to leave that alone. Amen. Look, I'm going to be simple with you. Just to wrap this up, she gets ready for me. We just live in a crap world because of sin. Beautiful planet God made. Beautiful creation made in us and all the 4,000 animals, mammals around us, all the fish, all that. But, man, if you let a person in, internet could be a beautiful thing. Inanimate object has no control over itself, but if you put some human beings to it, you're going to come up with the most nasty filth, garbage, trash, and horribleness that you can possibly imagine over and over and over and over and over and over again. Amen? Isn't that right? All you got to do is bring some people in, they'll mess it up. Right? Moms, dads, protect your kids. Lovingly protect them. Explain it to them. Make sure they understand what you're doing. You're not just being mean. You're being protective. It's not just because I said no. You know what? Big difference between discipline and punishment. Punishment, man, if you're doing just punishment, you're pulling the slingshot back. That's all you're doing. And when they get old enough, poo, they be gone. That's what punishment does. Discipline that comes with explanation, that comes in love, that comes because it's trying to be corrective, not because it just frustrated you until you can't see straight and you just blow your top and lose your cool and your control. That draws in. That draws in. Because we all get when somebody cares about us. We do. We get that. And if that's incorporated in that, then it becomes discipline. That's why when God disciplines you, it doesn't push you away. It draws you in. Because you know he loves you. You know he cares about you. You know he's doing it for a good reason. You parents, man, I'm glad I am not you. That's right. Very good. Good time. Let's stand. I'm glad I'm not you. This day and time, all things we're confronted with. All of us, you grandparents that are there to help and assist, same thing. It's rough. It's hard.
He is jealous for me. Love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy.
Anything you have undone. Anything standing in your way today.
All of a sudden, I am all
get rid of it. These altars are open. You need to come this morning.
And I realize just